Hello. Well, what I'm going to talk about seemed really simple at first. From online discussions regarding the Joker-like appearance of this image, I decided to find out what a Joker actually looked like in Jacobean England. And so I embarked upon this investigation of card play during the time of the First Folio production. And although it only took a few clicks of the mouse to determine that a Joker was an American addition to the 19th century card deck, those few mouse clicks were enough to draw my attention to a potential context embedded in the language and the imagery of the First Folio preface, a context I'd never before considered. Through deeper research, I uncovered an extensive lexicon of card-playing references planted throughout the introductory material, full of allusions stemming from the culture of the Italian Renaissance and with roots intertwining the First Folio catalogue itself. Ultimately, what I concluded from my study forever will change how I view Shakespeare's works. And after I've taken you on this 30-minute crash course and the lessons I've learned, I hope that that the surprising conclusions I reached will resonate and bide with you too. Having satisfied my interest in the provenance of the Joker, I decided to delve into the language of the epigram accompanying the First Folio portrait. Cards are read, as well as played with, I thought. So what other readers might Ben Jonson have been addressing? I was immediately struck by his repetition of the word brass. Surely a classically educated writer with a rich vocabulary wouldn't have used a word twice, unless it was important. Returning online, I investigated the etymology of the word brass and found that brasse, in the French language, Catherine, is a verb used to express the action of shuffling playing cards. Oops. Ah, well, that discovery prompted me to blow the dust off my French dictionary and begin translating the word poem by word by word, the poem's word by word. So figure, le figure, that's the French term for face card. Strife translates to a strife, and that's Old French for an activity related to card play in the titles of the two people who engaged in it. And a strife was a verbal tennis match, commenced by a question from the king that was answered nonsensically by the fool with the goal of provoking more questions from the king. The king, of course, was the name of one of the court cards well before the 1600s, and the fool predated the Joker by at least four centuries as the only numberless or zero-numbered card in any deck. Excuse me, just listen, I'll get to that, okay? Moving on to surpass, I discovered that it's the French equivalent for surpasser, one of the verbs used to indicate winning at cards, regardless of tactics. Somewhere in the process of translating Jonson's poem into French, what really should have been obvious to me from the start, and you, is how many English card-playing words we've been overlooking. I've highlighted those in green. And it took only a scan of the OED to verify that Jonson in his lifetime would have known that all seven of these common words could have been applied to card playing too. And then there are these words intrinsic to the production of playing cards. Renaissance engravers, carved woodblocks, used to print playing cards onto folio-sized sheets of linen paper, the same size and type of paper used to publish the First Folio. And then copper plate engraving. That was the art practiced by Martin de Ruchot, and it was used for printing playing cards after the technique was perfected in the 16th century by de Ruchot's Flemish countrymen. Picture cards was an early expression indicating expensive custom-made packs with symbols meaningful to the owners hand-painted upon the cardstock, like these. 3 of 15 surviving cards from such a pack. The set is believed to have been made around 1460 for the marital union of the Visconti, noble Visconti, and the merchant Sforza families of Milan. You can see on the skirt of the seated figure, maybe, there's a three-ring emblem of the Sforza families, and beneath it, the ducal crown of Milan that was claimed by the Visconti. After sussing out these card gaming and manufacturing terms, I thought perhaps I'd discovered all the words, but some of my fellow Oxfordians, Dr. Stripmatter and Shelley Maycott, encouraged me and said that I was maybe onto something deeper. So I kept digging, and I came across this piece of doggerel by the Waterman poet John Taylor. It was published in 1621 and features the names of a myriad of games by which a wealthy man through card play could have drained his estate. From Taylor's rhyme, I discovered that put was the name of a card game, and it was one that was notorious for its highly organized system of cheating involving facial expressions. I think it would have been kind of fun to play. I didn't find it a description for the game look, but was able to learn that there was other to-the-reader vocabulary mingled in the jargon of the rules for playing some of these old games. To do someone in Jacobean England meant to swindle them. But in an honest game of cards, if there's such a thing, to outdo could refer to a D-O. You notice that's a double O. You don't see two O's in a D very often in Renaissance printing. A D-O, short for a doubling out, which was an expression used in trick play. And then there's the word life. Although William Congreve believed the game Lodum was an actual threat to a player's good name, the loss of one's life was its figurative consequence. Players began the game Lodum with three games called lives and competed to kill off all the other players. Like the popular Rouennais pattern cards that are being enjoyed here by some of our good friends, until the London card makers established their first guild in 1628, the playing cards that most English most commonly would have used were cheaply mass-produced cards from northern France and were exported to England in packs of 36 to 78 cards. At least two of Jonson's plays have card playing underpinnings. The Mask of Christmas, in The Mask of Christmas, one of the characters referred to as a child is named Post and Pear. It always kills me, I don't know why. The game Primero was mentioned in Merry Wives of Windsor and in Henry VIII, but Primero is also mentioned, referenced several times in The Alchemist. In fact, one of the two crooks in The Alchemist assumes several aliases during the course of the action, but is named only in the character list as Face. And face, like put and do and surpass, are not the only words related to card play into the reader that have an additional nefarious connotation. I've highlighted those in purple. Bashing my face with this. You may be surprised to see that book is on the list, but to the English Puritans, cards were known as the devil's books. Despite pressure from the clergy, James allowed card playing throughout his kingdom, protecting would-be gamers from the blame of the learned men who think them hazards. He expressly permitted honest house games as cards, French cards called tarot, tables, and such like plays. Moving now to this figure we've all come to know and love. He also has a few card tricks tucked up his sleeves. Today, Bill is modeling for us a close-fitting jacket called a doublet. Isn't that curious? Doublet was a card game. It was based on a gambling term meaning two of a kind. A pair of matching cards is a doublet. If you lived in London in 1623 and subscribed to the notion that our model resembled a jester or a fool, then a word you might have used to describe it would have been naughty. Naughty was a pejorative synonymous with fool. Let's see, what else? New cut. Oh, that was a card game, but it was also the style of a beard. I can't attest that the stubble drew shout painstakingly engraved on Bill's chin is representative of such a shave, but I'm willing to posit that the reason behind that unusual, unkempt facial hair bespeckling the portrait is because of the card game, New Cut. Now, look at those pointy seams on the collar. In French, those shapes could be called piquets, although you won't find it listed in that Taylor's motto, which I'll be passing out later. You'd be right if you guessed that piquet, often pronounced picket, by the Jacobians, is another card game they played. And this picture shows something else the word piquet evokes. It was a name of a device used by the militaries in the 16th and 17th centuries to torture prisoners and spies. And last, but in no way least, how about the overall shape of that iconic collar? Isn't it nice here being worn by children and women and crown criminals? You can see one here on a knight card, a knight playing card from a Spanish deck circa 1616. It's known as a whisk collar. Whisk was a card game too. So, and I just lost my page. It was regarded as a low-class game and was associated with cheating and was also the precursor of the game we now know as whist. It's likely the basic rules of the game have changed less dramatically through time than its name. Looking back through the centuries, the game has been called all these things, but as you can see, it was originally called Trump. Yeah, Trump. And for those of you who are fed up with politics, if you can get past the discomfort of hearing me say this word at least 30 more times, I promise that the word Trump is pivotal to my new understanding of the First Folio preface and catalogue. It's going to be huge. So anyway, looking back to the word's origins in this 1500 BC, as the name of a hymn to honor the triumphs of the god Dionysus. This chart follows the word's development over 3,000 years to its eventual Italian gaming use in carta da trionfi, which meant cards of triumph. That was the original rollout name for those picture cards I showed you earlier. Over time, carta da trionfi came to be nicknamed a tutti, or a tu, by the French nobles who took a fancy to them. The combined packages of 22 atuti plus 56 old-style regular playing cards eventually became known as trocchi by the 16th century Italians, while similar 78 card French design packs assumed the name of tarot around the same time. For simplicity, I'll be referring to both atuti and atut as trump cards because that's what both nicknames mean in English. Once the trump cards were added to older style decks, games were developed to be played with more cards. But these non-suited 22 newcomers didn't just raise the price and the height of the card stack. They were included for a didactic purpose of changing the very nature of card play. From just the gambler's perspective, the 22 cards, including a numberless fool card like this one, sequentially worth from 1 to 21 points. So I'm getting dry here. These cards were called trumps because whatever their number, or in the fool's case, lack of number, they always triumphed over all the suited cards during bid play. But the new cards featured an array of archetypal thematic images that were designed to depict universal themes of character and destiny. Invented in the royal courts of northern Italy, the trump cards were created to enhance the variety of play by bringing old legends, mythology, and storytelling to a former numeric pastime. This aim was achieved by adding galvanizing images to card decks, provocative pictures of miniature art described by the cultural historian Michael Dummett as illustrating people, events, ideas, and emotions that shape and populate the imagination. Although there has been some renumbering and renaming of the cards through the centuries, as well as some swapping of male and female figures, from ancient pamphlets on the Italian tarocchi and from complete surviving decks of early French tarot cards, we know exactly what the 22 trump themes and images commonly had been and what they were at the time of the first folio, at the publication of the first folio. Here, for example, are some lovers' theme trump cards from 1464 to 1903. We can see how the images remained essentially the same through the centuries on some early Italian and French cards, and later on an English-made card. The only significant difference between the 22 trump cards of the 15th century to what is now referred to by occultists as the Tarot Major Arcana is that during at least the first 350 years of existence, until late in the 18th century when they took hold as the tools of choice for the mystical arts, trump cards were used for all sorts of gameplay. You know, just as our hands weren't made for the purpose of palmistry or we don't grow tea leaves to read them, the use of trump cards solely for cardomancy has been a downstream application of their original design. if a young English traveler were to have taken his first tour of Italy in, say, last quarter of the 16th century, he would have seen card games being dealt and bet upon in much the same way as they were enjoyed in his native land. But if the traveler were also a young nobleman with a facility for other languages and the aesthetic interests of a dramatic poet, imagine how his own writing might have been influenced by having had the opportunity to have read in Italian Pietro Aretino's Le Carte Parlanti, The Talking Cards, or the dialogues of Torquato Tasso, who philosophized on the tarocchi as art. And then imagine our young traveler spending a day first seeing in person cards being used by the Italians in ways that likely were new to him, drawn from ornate boxes, these elaborate gilded packs that had pictures so vivid and exquisite they were prized as wedding gifts. Then being employed in a wildly popular public sport called between exuberant wordsmiths, and it was called Tarocchi Appropriati, where an on-the-spot poetry pieces were improvised and recited with the goal of incorporating trump card themes. After that, our traveling friend might have dropped in on a theatrical revival of a drama from 1526 called Caos del Triperuno. Do I have that there? Yeah. It was a play that included a scene in which the protagonist distributed random trump cards to his fellow actors on stage before he spouted spontaneous sonnets to them based on the cards. And then our traveler could have boarded a trinket and retired to the private confines of a waterside villa to be engaged throughout the night in the play of creative parlor games, such as one witnessed at a party attended by Girolamo Cardano in 1572. Yes, that Girolamo Cardano. Cardano reported that each player was given a trump card selected by their host, and then reasons were stated aloud by those at the gathering as to what characteristics the guest had in common with the card their host had chosen for them. Another game played by the Italian well-to-do required a complete book of complete pack of 78 tarocchi cards, plus a lot book, such as this one published in 1540 by the famous Venetian typographer Francesco Marcolino. Upon opening the book, the reader was invited to select one of many oracular questions concerning personal destiny, and then the reader was directed to draw blindly two cards from the tarocchi deck. By thumbing through the book, then pairs of the cards, see like there, the pairs of cards could be found, and adjacent on the page would be the answer to the chosen question in the form of an abstract tercet, a three-line haiku-like sonnet. The poems in this book had been composed using imagery taken directly from the pairs of tarocchi cards. The author of the tercets in this book was a Venetian poet and a playwright, often ridiculed by his peers for his ineptitude with the Greek language, but much admired by them for his poem about Adonis and his translation of Ovid's Metamorphoses, named Lodovico Dolce. His given name was the same as the perfect gentleman character of Othello. His surname in English, too, means gentle, and that's how he was described. For several centuries, trump cards continued to be used for regular trick and bid play, too, such as in a 36-card game called Trappola, a name in English which really got my attention because it means mousetrap. I'm returning again to this graphic because to appreciate the breadth of card playing references used in the First Folio preface, I want to be sure you recognize that the earliest trump card themes and images were believed by many historians to have been inspired by the writing of Francesco Petrarca, known to us as Petrarch. The evidence used for this historical supposition is that the poet lived in Milan in the 14th century with no other than the Visconti, whose descendants less than 100 years ago commissioned the first known Carta de Trionfi, such as these, and the publication of Petrarch's poetic work, written in Italian and called, like the cards, I Trionfi, was the culminating achievement of his stay with the Visconti in Milan. interpreted in these paintings on that were on wedding chests from around 1444, and I saw them yesterday. They are now framed, but it's a wonderful museum. I encourage you all to go. Petrarch's Triumphi were allegorical recreations of Roman triumphs, a poetic series of conquests acted out by the embodied themes of love, chastity, death, fame, time, and eternity. And I don't know if you can see on this here because it's too small, but this figure here, I'm going to show you this figure later on a playing card. I didn't know that until yesterday. Hey, there's that picture. Although the dual use of the name would suggest it was so, it isn't known for certain that the title of Petrarch's I Triumphi actually brought about the naming of the playing cards. But we do know from extant records that his own descriptive name for his poetic writing was Trifles, which has the same spelling in Italian and the same meaning in English. And we also know that trifles is the same word used three times to describe Shakespeare's plays, three times in the first of the two Hemings and Condell epistles to the preface to the First Folio. Petrarch's triumphal form, with the triumphator lauded between odes to lesser mortals and greater gods, was also imitated by Jonson in his two My Beloved, the Author poem in the First Folio preface. So I had to wonder, what was Ben Jonson trying to tell us with his imitation of Petrarch and his to-the-reader epigram laden with card-playing terms, both bound together with that bizarre cover portrait? And there were other little details, too. 14 buttons on the doublet of the Durchschaut, just like the number of cards in each suit of a Tarocchi deck. 36 plays in the First Folio, just like the amount of cards used in Italian games played with Tarocchi. 78 lines in the combined Hemings and Condell dedications, just like the number of cards in a Tarocchi pack. Were the plays printed together like cards to be offered like Tarocchi as a wedding gift to Prince Charles? The answer to this last question came to me like a bolt of lightning and sat me up in bed in the middle of the night. I am not kidding. I said out loud, "The magician, yes." I suddenly knew the relevance of a notation in the account book of Queen Elizabeth's Master of the Revels, when in 1582, Edmund Tilney's officers were commanded to show on St. Stephen's Day at night before Her Majesty at Windsor a comedy or moral devised on a game of cards. After months of studying the historical development of card play, the nature of the Italian Tarocchi and French Tarot themes, and the ways the trump cards were used as poetic language and imagination generators during the Italian Renaissance, I realized that the plays included in the First Folio were thematically influenced by the trump cards, the same attuti or attute for which there is a record of use in Italy and France during the time the plays were being written, and used in England too, shortly before the First Folio was being published. I also had a strong suspicion that the sequence of the plays in the catalog was structured to imitate the numbered order of the trump cards. I turned on the light and got out of bed to check. The first hint that the trump card themes not only aligned with the major themes of the plays, but were mirrored in the catalog order was with that troublesome first play, The Tempest. How much ink has been put to paper over the question, why is The Tempest listed first? The number one card of the Tarot Major Arcana today is now called The Magician. In the 16th and early 17th centuries, the number one trump was known as the mountebank, Il Bagatto in Italian, or Le Butler in French. Characterized as a trickster or a charlatan, a mountebank was sort of a grandiose snake oil salesman. The mountebank then, or the magician card now, has depicted a male figure with his hands extended, preparing to manipulate four objects on a table. The shapes were meant to represent individually the elements of water, earth, air, and fire. Can you think of any other character in the Shakespeare canon that more intrinsically personifies a magical mountebank and also demonstrates in the course of the action comparable control over the elements, the physical elements of the play, other than Prospero and The Tempest? Then there's the second play in the folio lineup, Two Gentlemen of Verona. Well, I could take the easy route and say the second trump card also has a two in it. But the number two trump card was known at the time of the First Folio production as the Papessa, a female pope. The history of this card theme is thought to go back to the 9th century when there was a pope named John VIII who many of his detractors believed was really a woman in disguise. The plot of Two Gentlemen of Verona, of course, hinges on the action of two women disguised as a man. The number three trump is the Empress. She is thematically a mother nature figure. Here we see her in this French card from 1600, seated wearing a crown of fire on her head. Now, remember toward the end of The Merry Wives of Windsor, in which Mistress Quickly and the women come on stage to dance around Herne's Oak, dressed like urchins, oofs, and fairies, green and white, with crowns of waxen tapers on their heads? Probably not, because you know most directors these days just have the women carrying the candles for safety's sake, you know. But here is the same image in a tapestry from the 19th century. In surveying the rest of the comedies, this is the card and play pair that clinched it for me. Take a guess who it matches. Ours. I have it lanyard with the Star of David. Of course. Okay. And here are the rest of the comedies paired with what I am proposing are the trump cards that helped inspire them. I'll be passing all this later. Since it would take time, me well past my time, to go through each one of these and show you their features, at the end of my talk, I will be passing out an overview of the plays, play titles with the card names, as I believe they're paired, including the card images, and their identified mythological alter egos, which are important, and their common thematic interpretations. I recognize there's a certain subjectivity as to how well and if each card matches each play, so I'll appreciate your participation in evaluating my premise. As you make your assessments, bear in mind that, like the Italian lot book I showed you and the Tarocchi games I spoke of, the interpretation of one card will depend upon how the presence of other cards might mitigate or influence it. The trump cards I've come to appreciate are like perfect actors. They aren't meant to be soloists, but they are ready to react to fellow playing partners. And to prevent some of you mathematically minded spoil sports from calculating that there aren't enough trump cards to evenly pair with the 36 First Folio plays, I want to point out this is something I puzzled over too at 3 a.m. when I should have been sleeping. The numbers didn't add up. Still, I was satisfied that all the 14 comedies match quite well in thematic numeric sequence with the first 14 cards. So my next move was to help balance the equation by subtracting the 10 history plays. Perhaps besides not serving as a not so subtle augury that in light of the Spanish marriage crisis, that kings were vulnerable to being discarded at the whim of their subjects, I weighed this decision as a student of card play. I knew that the Spanish card decks at the time had no tens in them. But I also knew that Jonson particularly enjoyed the card game piquet, a game said to have originated in Spain before it was brought to the English court at the marriage of Queen Mary to King Philip. In most card games, the face cards have the highest values and therefore are retained by players in order to score the most points on a trick. But in the 36 card game piquet, which is a game for two, one of the rules is that players can actually score the most points by having no face cards left in their hands. It's called a carte blanche, and it's worth 10 points. Still, after subtracting the 10 history plays, I remained short by four cards. Proceeding then to the tragedies, I reviewed their predominant themes and compared them with the remaining cards, and then made the assessment that the cause of the imbalance was due to the fact that three of the trump card themes were used more than once. This chart shows the tragedies with what I believe are their strongest trump card pairings and how the numeric order is maintained despite the duplicate use of some cards. You can see that number 18 here in the middle, the moon card, matches three plays. This one really just blew me away. This card was appreciated by the 16th century Tarocchi players as an embodiment of the triplicate goddess Hecate. the crone who shared her power with the two younger goddesses, Artemis and Selene. The three plays linked with the moon in descending order all have strong thematic expressions of phases of the moon, from the light-thieving new moon of Timon to Julius Caesar's full moon, Ides, and then down to the disillusioned waning moon of Macbeth. There's the triple goddess. And while the moon card stands out for its triplicity, standard interpretations of trump cards do consider their oppositional duality as an essential part of their characteristics. Each card can manifest both a positive and negative trait, except for the devil and tower cards, which are believed by many to have no redeeming features whatsoever. And do note that by my calculations, both these cards end up being matched with problem plays, believed by many to have no redeeming features either. This is the oldest known surviving fool card. That's the guy I pointed out earlier. It's from the same 15th century Visconti Sforza deck I've shown you. In trick and bid plays, played alone, the fool was worth nothing. But when laid down with a suited card, any suited card, it acted as an excuse to change the suit of the card with which it was played and thereby bring points to a trick when there otherwise would have been no points for either card. Only through partnership with a lowly non-trump card was the fool able to prevail, and vice versa. Readers of tarot today, I've been told, study the cards as an arc of the fool's journey through self-knowledge. They trace the movement of his soul. I pair the fool with Cymbeline, a play that wanders between Britain and in Italy, with a plot that's been described as akin to the entire Shakespeare canon swirled together in a blender. The fool card is also a wanderer and is interpreted to have a presence in and an aspect of every other trump card, similar to how a fool character is present, either present or referred to, in every play of the Shakespeare canon. My goal in this presentation has been to lay down Jonson's cards face up for all of you to see. Yet this fool-like image, which initiated my quest 6 months ago, still remains an enigma. The content of the First Folio preface suggests two identities for this picture we see here put. One is a Roman death mask, such as those worn in 50 BC by the anonymous actors who were hired to parade as living stand-ins for deceased triumphators and then deliver their eulogies to them at their funerals. The other is like this image of the Countess of Pembroke, Mary Sidney Herbert, one of the many nobles whose faces were painted in miniature on the backside of playing cards by Nicholas Hilliard. Hilliard, the English limner and artist, most often put forward as having been inspired by Petrarch's poetry. If we were able to remove the Roman death mask from the Durchat engraving, I believe a hired player would show himself. But if we were able to flip Jonson's fool card over, like a miniature by Nicholas Hilliard, I think we'd find a noble portrait hidden on the other side. And now the question is, who might that be?
Thank you. Good, thanks.